Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Krishna,
Krishna, Krishna,
Krishna, Krishna,
Krishna, Krishna,
Hare Hare,
Hare Hare,
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama,
Rama Rama,
Rama Rama,
Hare Hare,
Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna,
Krishna Krishna,
Krishna Krishna,
Hare Hare,
Hare Hare,
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama,
Rama Rama,
Rama Rama,
Hare Hare,
Hare Hare,
Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama, Rama,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama, Rama,
Jaya Gauranitai,
Jaya Gauranitai,
Jaya Gauranitai,
Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Jaya Prabhupada,
Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada,
Prabhupada, Jaya Jaya Prabhupada,
Mitai Gora Hari Bol, Hari Hari bol Nitai Gaur Hari bol
Nitai Gaur Hari bol
Hari bol
Hari bol
Hari bol
Nitai Gaur Premanand
Hari Hari bol
परिवराज का आचार्य अष्टोत्र सत शीशी जोएंगे अभय चरणारविंद भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी शीला प्रभुपाद की अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की श्री चैतन्य चरितामृत की चैतन्य महाप्रभु की गौरव पूर्णिमा महामहोत्सव की निताई गौर प्रेमानंदे
Hare Krishna. Can you hear me online? Hare Krishna, can anybody online?
Hare, yeah.
Yes, now I have set it. Hare Krishna. Today's session is titled Parama Karuna, the Ocean of Mercy. Let us see what this means. See, 500 years ago, in the village of Navadvipam, on the auspicious full moon day of Falgun Purnima, another moon arose in the courtyard of Jagannath Mishra and Sachi Devi. He appeared to provide cooling shelter to the burning hearts of the people in the age of Kali. He was the golden avatar, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So today, let us hear about the glories of the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. I would like to quote this verse from the Adi Leela, 17th chapter, first verse from Chaitanya Charitamrita. Vande, vande swairab dhuteham tam chaitanyam yat prasadataha yavanaha sumanayante krishna nama prajalpakaha. Let me offer my respectful obeisances to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, by whose mercy even unclean yavanas become perfectly well-bred gentlemen by chanting the holy name of the Lord. Such is the power of Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It is customary that before we discuss the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as per Chaitanya Charitamrita, that we chant one more prayer, and I would like all of you to repeat after me. Jai Jai Shri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda.
Jai
Jai Shri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda. Jai Advaita Chandra Jai Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Jai
Jai Jai Shri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda. Jai Advaita Chandra Jai Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Jai
Jai Sri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda.
Jai Jai Sri Chaitanya Jai
जय अद्वैत चंद्र जय गौर भक्त वृंद All glories to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. All glories to Lord Nityananda Prabhu. All glories to Advaita Acharya. And all glories to all the devotees of Lord Chaitanya. With this, let us get into the depths of the mercy, of ocean of mercy of Lord Chaitanya. So this, we are talking about 500 years back. At this time, there was a very rigid system in the society at the time in India, especially the Hindu society at the time, 500 years back. The caste Brahmanas or the Smarthas were of the opinion, and in fact, even today, that is very prevalent, that one cannot become a Brahmana unless he changes his body. In other words, until he dies and is reborn in a Brahmana family. Until that happens, you cannot become a Brahmana. So unless you are born in a Brahmana family, there is no way for you to become a Brahmana. This is a very commonly held thought today. Definitely 500 years back, it was a very rigid thought which was held by Brahmanas, the Smarthas. The caste Brahmanas are the Smarthas. But by the supreme potency of the Lord, everything is possible. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is as fully independent as Krishna, Swarat. Therefore, no one can interfere with his activities. If he wants, by his mercy, he can convert even a Yavana. An unclean follower, Yavanas are non-Vedic people who do not follow the Vedic system. They are called Yavanas. So according to the Vedic system, there are four varnas and four ashramas. So those who do not belong to any of the four varnas, four orders of society, four divisions, that is Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Those who do not belong to any of these, and among those, there are many classifications. And Yavanas, Mlechas, etc. There are many different classifications. The 17th chapter of Chaitanya Charitamrita particularly starts with this verse that we just read about Yavanas and how by the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, even Yavanas can be converted to Brahmanas. So if he wants, by his mercy, he can convert even a Yavana. What is there? Into a perfectly well-behaved gentleman. We have seen in the Krishna consciousness movement, which was propagated all over the world by Srila Prabhupada, how several of the Western followers who are not born in India, who have no prior introduction to the Vedic system, never heard about Krishna, had unclean habits. In many, many ways, they had no concept of regulative principles. But even such people were converted into perfectly well-behaved gentlemen. Thousands of members of the Krishna consciousness movement were similarly converted. And they became such wonderful devotees. How did they become? Simply by chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. And even in India, these Yavanas, who thus got transformed into well-behaved gentlemen, devotees, they were well-received, even in India, as well-behaved Vaishnavas wherever they went. So this transformation of converting Yavanas or those who are not followers of Vedic system, this miracle is actually the special mercy, the special power of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. In fact, the body of a Krishna conscious person changes in many ways. When the non-Indian Western followers, disciples of Srila Prabhupada, they were dancing on the street, chanting and dancing, with clean shaven heads, very clean appearance, very gentlemanly behavior. The American gentlemen and the ladies, they would inquire, are you really American? How did this happen? What happened to you? They could not believe it. They could not believe the physical transformation that happened. How the body of a person who's unclean, who's just lying on the street as a hippie, how that got transformed. It is actually nobody could believe it. They could not comprehend this transformation. So these are bodily transformation that happened. And these actually, Srila Prabhupada notes this in this particular 17th chapter. He notes that this is in fact by the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So today, let us hear about some pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, particularly about how he transformed some of the Yavanas into devotees. This 17th chapter of Chaitanya Charitamrita is describing the life of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu from the age of 16 to the age of 24. This is the period of his life that this particular chapter is describing. There are several pastimes in this. We will not have the time to discuss all the pastimes, but there are some very interesting pastimes which I would like to put before you that illustrate his, in fact, any pastime of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It is not possible to come away with any impression except for a immense sense of gratitude and disbelief about the extent of his mercy, the extent to which he gave himself to the community, to his disciples, to people in general who are not even perhaps eligible to receive any mercy, you may think. The people who are not eligible in any way. By our calculations, we would think that they were perhaps not at all eligible. But still, for such people, how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave his mercy that is present, that can be seen in every one of his pastimes. So today we will see some of them. So at the age, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to school at a very early age. At the age of 5, he went to one school. And then at the age of 8, he changed to a different school. And then within 2 years or so, after he had mastered languages, Sanskrit, I think Bengali also, he had sufficiently mastered. Then he stayed at home and he used to study the books which were present in the house, which were being used by his father, Jagannath Mishra. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's father's name is Jagannath Mishra. Mother's name, Sachidevi. So his father, Jagannath Mishra, it is described as he was a Brahmana in the Vedic order. So there were several texts, Sanskrit texts at home. He used to study them and very soon he had mastered them. And as he grew older, he started exhibiting sporadic symptoms of ecstasy. There were certain times when he would simply melt into ecstasy. And he would encourage others around him also to similarly engage in activities of devotional service. And sometimes his activities would appear to be irrational. Actually, as per Ayurveda, there are three elements in the body. That is Vayu, Pitta, and Kapha. Vayu is also called Vata. Vata, Pitta, Kapha, or Vayu, Pitta, Kapha. There are three elements. And when the three are in balance, then the body is healthy. But when the three go out of balance, then the body starts producing mucus and there is some disturbance of air within the body. And it is said in Ayurveda that when this goes out of balance, particularly when the Vayu and the Pitta goes out of balance, there are 59 kind of diseases that come about in the body. One of them is to become crazy. So on the plea of disturbance of Vayu and Pitta metabolism, Pitta means metabolism, fire, and the air, on the plea that my metabolism and my air are all messed up, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to become crazy or act crazy. If somebody was asking, he will simply say, oh, no, my metabolism is all messed up. He used to say like that, and he would do whatever he wanted. And what did he want? He would overturn the rules of Sanskrit grammar and explain the grammar in terms of Krishna. So all the grammatical rules, everything he will explain by using examples of Krishna. And to ordinary people, this will appear strange because Sanskrit is not a new language. It's not that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu invented that. He's a 16-year-old boy. And he goes around inverting the rules of grammar and explaining everything by using Krishna. So, so this was very strange. In fact, I remember when I was a young boy, my family, my uncles or aunts, if they, sometimes if I did something stupid, they will say, looks like your pitta is increased. It means I've gone crazy. I'm doing something crazy. This is a common saying in India. If pitta is increased, means it's an indirect way of saying that you have become crazy. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to act out these kinds of things, and it was wonderful to see that. It was strange for most people. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's purpose, he had a purpose in doing this. So his purpose in this attitude of craziness, what was the purpose? It was to explain that there is nothing within our experience but Krishna consciousness. For everything may be dovetailed with Krishna consciousness. Everything we see in our ordinary life, it can be seen with respect to Krishna. To us, it now looks normal because Prabhupada has explained it that way to us. Right? That how we see everything in relation to Krishna. But to the ordinary people at the time, this was very new. It is not that everyone knew about this Krishna consciousness. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has inaugurated this movement and now Prabhupada has propagated all over the world. Therefore, for people like us, we have heard about this principle that everything should be seen in relation to Krishna. But at the time, this is completely new. And he wanted to establish this. So he used to act like this. And this was one of his beginning stages. Of course, even prior to this, as a child, he has shown several miracles. Maybe in another future class, somebody else may explain that. I've already gone to the age of 16. But this is a display of his mercy, of how he wants to propagate Krishna consciousness in the world. And this is one of the beginning he has made. So there was a time when his father passed away. And Jagannath Mishra passed away. He went to Gaya to offer oblations. It is customary that when father or mother passes away, then the boy in the house, they will go to Gaya and they will offer oblation to the lotus feet of Vishnu. And so following that custom, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also went there. And there he met Ishwarapuri. So once he met Ishwarapuri, he was completely transformed. Ishwarapuri gave him initiation. And thereafter, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would always be in ecstasy. Until that point, he was sporadically in Krishna, externally manifested Krishna consciousness. There were times when he would simply talk about grammar, Nyaya, Vyakaran. And there were times when he would talk about Krishna consciousness prior to that. But once he went to Gaya and returned back, he was completely in spiritual ecstasy. Sometimes crying, sometimes laughing, sometimes rolling on the floor. He would always be immersed in the symptoms of ecstasy. On the way to Gaya, what happened was he fell ill. This is before going to Gaya. So when he was on the way, he had fever. He told his disciples, you please get the charanamrit of a brahmana. So you wash the feet of a brahmana and you take that water and bring it to me. So his disciples did that. They found a pious, pure brahmana. They washed his feet, took that water. And when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu drank that water, his fear went away. So this pastime illustrates his respect for the brahmanas. We started off this session by speaking about the rigidity of caste brahmanas, how they would not accept that unless you are born in a Brahmin family, they would not accept you have to die and be reborn in a Brahmin family. Only then they would be accepted. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu showed all respects to brahmanas. But at the same time, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has said this, does not mean that we go around washing the feet of brahmanas. Because today, in today's age, such brahmanas, pure brahmanas are not to be found. Generally, the people who are born in brahmana families, they take advantage of such a respectful sentiment that common people have. And therefore, because of the degradation of the age, with that, the brahminical class, the brahminical culture has also degraded. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu always, throughout his life, had the highest respect for Brahmanas. But we can be seen that throughout his life, the caste Brahmanas all never had difficulty in accepting him. And they would always be plotting various schemes on how to act against him. But still, you will see how he dealt with them. And that is one of his greatest mercies as well. Once, this is another pastime that happened. Once his mother, Sachidevi, made a mental offense against Advaita Acharya. So Sachidevi's older son, they had many children, but then his the last surviving child before Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, his name was Vishwarupa. And Vishwarupa had taken sannyas when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very young. And his mother was distraught, was very, very, very inconsolable. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu consoled her by saying that, I will take care, don't worry, I'll be here. But this always, Sachidevi had this in her mind that perhaps Advaita Acharya has coaxed her son Vishwarupa to take sannyas. So she was having this grudge against, you can say, in a small way. Although Sachidevi was a pure devotee, it is said by Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami that Nanda Maharaj has appeared as Jagannath Mishra and Yashoda Devi, Yashoda Mata, Yashoda Maya, she has appeared as Sachidevi. But there is a pastime where Sachidevi, out of her maternal affection for her son, Vishwarupa, thinks that Advaita Acharya is behind Vishwarupa's taking of sannyas. So she commits a mental offense. She scolds him within her mind. This nobody would have known because it is happening in her mind. If somebody were to take account of how many times we commit mental offenses against people, there is no account of it. But Sachidevi was very pure. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is omniscient, immediately came to know about it. Advaita Acharya, who is a Vishnu Tattva, he also came to know about it. So except for these two people, nobody else knew. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu considered that this were allowed to happen, then Chaitanya, it will not be good for Sachidevi. So he wanted to correct this. Once what happened, there was a situation where some of his disciples were able to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's divine form. There was a pastime where, I believe it is called the Mahaprakasha pastime, where he was showing his divine form to some of his confidential devotees. And then one of his confidential devotees, they suggested, can we get Sachi Mata, can we get Sachidevi also to see your divine form? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, no, it's not possible. My mother has committed an offense against Advaita Prabhu, so I will not show her this form. This information was carried forward by that confidential associate of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to his mother. And when the devotees told Sachidevi what her son had told, she immediately went to Advaita Acharya and begged him for forgiveness. After Advaita Acharya heard Sachidevi's confession, he began to glorify her as one who had carried the Supreme Lord of all creation within her womb. Because after all, Sachidevi had given birth to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Advaita Acharya did not take offense at all. Instead, he started glorifying her. And he did not stop glorifying, because he, in his heart, he had such respect for Sachidevi, who was a mother of Lord Chaitanya, his worshipable Lord. So he kept on glorifying, until he fell unconscious. To that point, he kept on glorifying. And at that point, Sachidevi took the opportunity and took the dust from the lotus feet of Advaita Acharya and put on her forehead. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu learned about this. He knew that this has happened and he was very satisfied with that. So thus Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saved Sachidevi from an offense, and then later he said, now my mother's offense at the lotus feet of Advaita Acharya has been rectified. Now she may have love of Krishna without difficulty. So after this point, this was one obstacle. So this is a pastime that highlights how the Vaishnava Aparadha, even if for a person who's so pure, but if there is a Vaishnava Aparadha, then that will immediately put a check on one's progress. So one can be very grateful to the Lord for illustrating this example. After this incident, one day Advaitacharya requested Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to display the universal form that he had shown to Arjuna, universal form, Virat Rupa. And Lord Chaitanya agreed to this. And Advaitacharya was fortunate enough to see the universal form of the Lord. So thus he had this kind of a mercy on Advaitacharya. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to regularly lead congregational chanting of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra in the house of Srivasa Thakura. So there was a time when he used to do that for one full year, entire year, every day evening, they used to have the chanting, congregational chanting of Hare Krishna Mahamantra. And he taught some very important principles during that time. So first he said that Harer Nama, Harer Nama, Harer Nama Eva Kevalam, Kalau Nasti Eva, Nasti Eva, Nasti Eva, Gatir Anyatha. And he gave elaborate description of this as well, how the significance of the different portions of this mantra, perhaps that can be a subject of another class by itself. But essentially in this age of Kali, there is no other process, than to take to the chanting of the holy names of the Lord. This is the only process. Harer Nama, Harer Nama, Harer Nama Eva Kevalam. So he stressed on this Kevalam and said that there is no other process. And this chanting of the holy names must be done in a humble state of mind. And he gave this verse, Trinadapi Sunichena, Taroriva Sahishnuna, Amananiya Manadena, Kirtaniya Sadahari. And he said that one should wear this mantra as a garland around our neck and constantly chant the holy names. So Trinadapi Sunichena, he gave elaborate description of this as well as to how one should chant this in the humble state of mind. So they used to have these congregational chanting events, and the chanting was often performed in closed doors. So when they would reach a state of ecstasy, they would close the doors. The reason was there were many non-devotees who were there around that area, and they would sometimes come and participate only to make fun of the process of chanting, because this process of chanting to us now, we are familiar. But at the time, this was not very commonly followed. Chanting of the holy names in ecstatic singing and dancing, it was all new for them. And there were some of these caste brahmanas who used to come out of prestige. There is some activities happening here, let us go and participate. They will go and participate, but they will make fun. They'll come outside and they'll say, "Are kya hua pata hai kal?" And they'll start making fun. And because to avoid this, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his close confidential associates used to close the doors. But this made some of them very envious, Brahmanas. So there is one particular Brahmana by the name Gopala Chapala. And he was very rough in his speech. He was offensive, very talkative, very offensive. So he plotted a scheme, and he kept some paraphernalia outside Srivasa Acharya's house, which is used in the worship of Bhavani, Durga. Bhavani worship, it is one of the tantric cults of people. It is considered a lower level of worship. It is lower than the, even Brahmanas, even Smarthas would not do this. This is a kind of Shaktas. There's a sect of people called Shaktas who would worship. They are generally meat eaters. They drink alcohol. And one of the items of worship offered is sometimes meat and alcohol. All of this is offered to Bhavani. So he kept some of those paraphernalia outside his house at the time when nobody was there. So next day morning when Srivasa Acharya came outside, he saw, what is this? And he then called his neighbors and said, "Look, what has happened? Now you can all see what my real position is. I'm actually a Shakta Bhavani worshipper. You're all thinking I'm a Vaishnava. It is not like that. Look at this in front of my house, what has kept." So the others, they were all very disturbed. His neighbors, they were all good meaning neighbors. They were all very disturbed and they were wondering who did this. Of course, nobody knew who did this. Even today, there is in Bengal, if you see, there is, at the time also it was there. There was always this tension between Shaktas and Vaishnavas. Today also, you see, there is a Kalima, Jai Kalima, Jai Shri Ram, two camps are there. So this kind of a thing was going on at the time also. And generally the Shaktas, they are sentimentalists, they are do not follow regulative principles. And this Gopala Chapala, he wanted to bring down the prestige of Srivas Acharya and the community. But Srivas Acharya, of course, himself was not affected. But very soon after that, Gopala Chapala became afflicted with leprosy. And his body started pouring blood, oozing blood and mucus and other things, what happens in leprosy, and very much pain, it was in deep pain. And then he went out of the city. He started living, and those days, this would happen if somebody were contracted with leprosy, they would have to leave the village, they'll have to go outside. So he went outside and he was sitting there in great pain. And one day Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went that way. And he immediately approached Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and said, "Oh Lord, see what has happened. You are the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Now look at me, my condition. Please help me and fix my wounds." So it appears as Gopala Chapala, he was offensive in his speech, etc. But he was simple enough. He knew that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But he did not realize what was the purpose to approach the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He thought that God means he should fix material problems. So he was approaching him to fix his leprosy. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu knew better. Firstly he acknowledged his respectful obeisances, but then he said, "No, I will never excuse you. You have offended Srivas Acharya. I will never excuse you. You may have to be born as 10,000 times, thousands of births you'll have to take and suffer like this, but I will not excuse you." So he continued to suffer, Gopala Chapala. But much later, after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyas, later he forgave him and gave him instructions on how to get out of his condition. At that point, he told him to go back to Srivas Acharya, confess his crime, and seek forgiveness. So by this, and then later Srivas Acharya forgave him, and then he improved. So this pastime is given to illustrate how the Lord forgives and creates a path even for offensive persons who sincerely repent. Until a person sincerely repents, one cannot artificially go and say that, "All right, my condition, I have a problem, please fix it." It won't happen. Actually, all our troubles, it should be known that it is because Atma Kritam Vipakam. It is because of our own past impious activities, our own past offenses that we are suffering. And unless we sincerely repent, it is not possible for us to become free of our tribulations that we face in our life. One day, what happened when the Lord was performing Sankirtana with his devotees? After the Sankirtana was over, the devotees felt fatigue. They were a little tired because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he did the Sankirtana, it was wild. It was in great ecstasy. He used to dance and dance and dance, and sing and jump, roll on the floor. It was heavy. And not like our, sometimes in our morning, we just stand in one place and gently move our feet from left to right to left, swaying like this, very as if the body will break if we move a little bit more. Not like that. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's dance was let loose. And his followers were also like that. All the disciples, they would just completely, no inhibition, they used to dance. After that, the dancing was over, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu realized that everybody is fatigued. And he would say, "All right, enough." And one day it happened like that, they were fatigued. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sowed a mango seed in the yard. So he just took one mango seed and sowed it in the yard. And what happened? Immediately, that seed fructified into a tree. And it started to grow. And just as people were seeing, in front of their eyes, the tree became fully grown. And not only the tree became fully grown, but it had fruits that were fully ripened. And everyone was struck with wonder. How did this happen? A mango seed is planted, it becomes a tree, and the fruits come out, and the fully ripe fruits. The Lord immediately plucks two fruits, and it says actually 200 fruits. And then he washes them, because a lot of devotees, right? So all for all of them, the tree is full of fruits. And then he plucks the fruits, he washes them nicely, and then he offers them to the Lord. Then he takes one fruit and he has it. Then after that, he distributes all the fruits. So these fruits were, what kind of fruits were these? It was not just some variety of random variety of mango. It was a very, very special variety of mango. These mangoes were red and yellow. These red and yellow mangoes are supposed to be the best variety of mangoes. And the most wonderful thing about the mango was the mango was seedless. Have you ever seen, you've seen grapeless seedless grapes? You've seen seedless bottles? Watermelon, that also a little bit seeds will be there. They'll say seedless, but inside you open some 2-3 seeds will be there. Have you ever seen a seedless mango? This happened. So these mangoes were seedless. Not only they are seedless, they were also without skin. They didn't even have skin. So these mangoes were so special. They did not have skin. They did not have seeds. And there was nice big mangoes. One mango and full stomach would be full. Enough to fill a person. Just like that. So immediately all those fruits were distributed. And everybody started having those mangoes. And in this way, these fruits immediately grew back next day. And then again there was kirtan. Again, mango prasadam for everyone. The next day, again, the fruits grew back. Again, there was kirtan. Again, mango prasadam for everyone. Like this, day after day, every single day, for an entire year, this happened. It's a very wonderful pastime of the Lord, mango tree pastime. I think anyone who hears this pastime would be wonderstruck. We have heard of other...
Still, that place is known as Amragachi.
Amragachi. In Chaitanya Charitamrita, it is mentioned as Amraghata. Amraghata. Or Amaghata. Both names have been given. So, we have heard the story of Madhvacharya, how he strikes a stick on the ground and there's a tamarind tree. Isn't it tamarind tree or some tree like that comes up? But not like this, where mango tree comes, mango without the seeds, without skin, entire year devotees are having this wonderful pastime. Once like this, when kirtan, sankirtana was going on, a little bit distance from the village, there was no shelter, people were on the street and fully exposed. Suddenly, dense clouds appeared on the top, thunderstorms, heavy clouds. And people became afraid because this torrential downpour in West Bengal that can cause floods, flooding. It's not ordinary. Not like here that you just a little bit of rain comes in New England area and then we can actually walk in the rain also. No problem happens here. But in West Bengal, in that area, if heavy rains come, it can cause flooding and people can be washed away. It's not ordinary. It's not a small thing. So people, the devotees became very much afraid. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he just took his kartal and started looking at the sky and started chanting like this. Immediately the clouds went away. They got dispersed. So the devotees were all saved by the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that day. Another day, one great devotee of Lord Shiva came to their house and to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's house. So you would think that, oh, Lord Shiva's devotee means Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would have not reacted positively. But actually, he got into the mood of Lord Shiva. And he got into the shoulder of this devotee and started dancing. And they all danced for a long time and then that person went away. So like this, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to get into the mood. Sometimes Lord Narasingadev's mood, sometimes Varaha's mood. Like this, he used to go and get into different moods and go into different moods of ecstasy. Like this, there is another pastime where there is a tailor who comes and he is given darshan and he was given the mercy of the Lord. So like this, there are several such pastimes that happens. Now, the Lord, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he ordered all the residents of Navadvipa to chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra in each and every home. So every home in Navadvipa, we have seen how when Krishna was present personally in Vrindavan, every resident of Vrindavan, Krishna was the center. Whatever he said, they would do. Residents of Mathura, Krishna was the center. Similarly, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was there, residents of Navadvipa, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was the center. So when he asked the residents of Chaitanya of Navadvipa to start chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra, they would start chanting. Every day in every house, it started happening. And how they would perform, they would sing Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So along with chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra, they would also chant another song. Hari Haraya Namah Krishna, Yadavaya Namaha, Yadavaya Madhavaya, Keshavaya Namaha. So this song was very favorite. It's a favorite song of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It is mentioned in Chaitanya Charitamrita that this is a favorite song of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So in fact, if you, any of you online, if you are able to come to attend Mangalarti in our temple here, IHF Boston, this song is sung every day as part of Mangalarti. So this Sankirtana movement was started in Navadvipa and nobody could hear any other sound. Every house, Hari Hari, Hari Hari was going on. And the districts, so what happened? All these, some of the local Muslims, they became angry. Hey, what is happening? Till now people were all peaceful and Muslims were ruling. And now suddenly Navadvipa is flooded with Hare Krishna Mahamantra, Hari Hari, what is going on? And then they submitted one complaint to the local Qazi. Qazi means magistrate. He was a city magistrate. So this particular Qazi, his name was Chand Qazi. And they gave a complaint to him that this Hare Krishna people are out of control. Please do something. Now, this district of Nadia, Islampura, Bagoyana, they were all under the Zamindar by the name Hari Hoda. So this Zamindars, they used to control the land, they used to control tax, they used to collect the taxes. But the law and order was handled by Chand Qazi, the Qazi, the city magistrate. So law and order was handled by Qazi. So this fell into his jurisdiction. Qazi had to do something about it. So what happened? One day, this Chand Qazi was just not an ordinary magistrate. It is said that he was the spiritual master, so in Islamic tradition, spiritual master, of Nawab Hussain Shah. Nawab Hussain Shah, he was the spiritual master of Nawab Hussain Shah. So he was very well read. He was an educated person. He knew the Vedic literature as well as Quran, all those he knew. So this Chand Qazi, because of the submission by the Muslims, he became very angry. Hey, what is this? So many people are all chanting this. What has happened to them? Suddenly somewhere they got this energy. Let me go and see what happened. What is happening? So he comes to the house of one of the devotees, one of the residents of Navadvipa. And he comes in the evening time and he sees that heavy kirtan is going on. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare. If you have seen our Krishna Balaram Mandir, how evening time heavy kirtan happens. That is very wonderful to see. So you can imagine what will be happening in Navadvipa in time of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. What would be the energy, what would be the potency of the kirtan that are happening at the time. So he sees it's going on and then he takes the mridanga and breaks it. Breaks the mridanga. And angrily he says, for so long you did not follow the regulative principles of the Hindu religion, but now you're following them with great enthusiasm. May I know by whose strength you are doing so? Where have you got this bala, spiritual strength suddenly of doing kirtan? What happened to you? Till yesterday, your tail beating your legs, you're sitting down. So actually, at the time, from this statement, and this statement is there in Chaitanya Charitamrita, whatever I just said, it appears that the Vedic principles or the Vedic processes were greatly suppressed. Nobody could openly follow the essence, the actual principles. Some show they could do, but the actual Vedic principles they could not follow. That's why Chand Kazi is saying, what happened to you? Suddenly, where have you got this? By who's backing you? Like that. So previously, they could not follow, and suddenly they have started the strength, got the strength somewhere. So Chand Kazi said, from now on, no one should perform Sankirtana on the streets of the city. Today, I'm excusing the offense and returning home. The next time I see someone performing such Sankirtana, I shall certainly chastise him by not only confiscating all his property, but also converting him into a Muslim. So, see, this is 500 years back, let us remember. And there were such objections. So the local administration was opposed to Sankirtana. But if you see, 500 years later, Sankirtana movement is still going on. It's still going on. It has not been checked. So this is evidence of the fact that Sankirtana, Harinama Sankirtana, is a transcendental activity. It is said that anything that is transcendental cannot be checked by anything that is material. Activity on the spiritual plane cannot be hampered by material conditions. No matter what one's condition, one's devotional service to the Lord cannot be checked by any external circumstances. 500 years back, there are obstacles. Today also there are obstacles. Today also there are so many places where you go and try to do Sankirtana, it will not be. There will be people who will be objecting. But in spite of that, it is going on. So this is proof. Prabhupada says that this is the proof that Harinama Sankirtanam is transcendental activity. So in those days, converting a Hindu to Muslim was fairly easy. Not really. You just had to take a Muslim. If a Muslim were to take some water and sprinkle on a Hindu, that's all finished. Hindu became Muslim. The society was very rigid. This is a simple process. So simply by coming in contact with a Muslim like that, he would become a Muslim. Or sometimes if the administration wanted to make a bigger show, they would take some cow meat and they would forcibly feed people cow meat and thereby convert them into Islam. So this used to happen a lot. So Hindu society was at the time was quite rigid. And once a Hindu was like this converted, there was no ghar vapsi at the time. It's not possible. You're a Muslim means your life, that's all. Just as a caste Brahmana would never admit somebody else. You cannot, a person born in a Kshatriya family or a Shudra family cannot by performing some prayaschitta or some penance or something like that, cannot become a Brahmana. So similarly, once a Hindu becomes a Muslim, there was no going back. It was finished. Dharma Brashta. Over. So gradually at the time, the Muslim population had started increasing a lot under the Mughal Empire. This was a very common way. Very easily they could convert people forcibly and there was no recourse for it. So gradually the population had increased a lot. So after having threatened it, the devotee, the Qazi returned home. And the devotees were greatly shocked. Now, what did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu say? So the devotees went to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and said, this has happened. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ordered, go perform Sankirtana. Today I shall kill all the Muslims. He said like that. That's exactly what he said. And now, we know Gandhiji is very famous for having started the movement of non-violent civil disobedience in India. 500 years before him, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu started his movement of non-violent civil disobedience to the order of Chand Kazi. So it is not necessary to commit violence to stop the opposition from hindering movement, but rather using reason and argument, it can be prevented. So once they all came back after meeting Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they all went home and then they started again doing Sankirtana movement. But now, because Chandkazi had ordered them not to do it, they were a little bit anxious because they don't know when Chandkazi will come, break the mridanga, do some disruption, convert them to Muslim. They're all very anxious. So understanding the anxiety in the people's minds, the Lord one day, they called them all together and he says, all right, let us do one thing. In the evening, I shall perform Sankirtana in each and every town. So you should all go and decorate the city. So they all went home and they all decorated the cities. There were 9 cities, Navadvipa. It's a congregation, it's a mixture of 9 cities. So in all those 9 cities, there are all the towns were nicely decorated for Sankirtana. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave assurance. He says, in the evening, burn the torchlights in every home. I shall give protection to everyone. Let us see what kind of Kazi comes up to stop our Kirtana. And then in the evening, the Lord went out and then formed different Sankirtan parties. And so they formed 3 parties. And in fact, there is a detailed description also how these parties were formed. There were 4 Mridanga players. There were 16 Kartal players chanting. And then there was 1 lead singer. And like this, there were 3 such parties that were there. And gradually, as the parties moved forward and went through different cities, many hundreds and hundreds of people started following them. And gradually, the crowd swelled to thousands of people. And then they all went to, gradually, their whole group went to Kazi's house, Chandkazi's house. And seeing this crowd coming, approaching, Chandkazi became a little bit afraid. And look, at big crowd is coming. And he went inside the house and hid himself, did not come. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu alone came. He asked everyone to be quiet and remain peaceful. But meanwhile, people were becoming anxious. They were all getting angry, restless, because they wanted to take revenge on this Chandkazi for creating disturbance. So they started disturbing his garden. So those days, Kazi means they have a big lawn, big, nice, big bungalow with a lot of garden, etc. So they started uprooting some plants, destroying the rose plant, etc. So he said, no, all right, hold on, I'll go and speak. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to their doorstep and waited there for some time. Then after some time, he sent somebody inside and said to get Chandkazi out. So Chandkazi came down with head bowed like that, respectfully. And then the Lord, now remember, the Lord has thousands of people here. So as such, the Lord could have been right there. He could have one stroke, ek mar do tukde, he could have done. But he did not do that. Instead, he gave him a lot of respect and ask him to say, take a seat. So you can see here how the Lord is treating an official functionary with respect. He's not abusing his power that he has got. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asks Chandkazi, sir, I have come to your house as a guest, but upon seeing me, you hid yourself in a room. What kind of etiquette is this? And to this, Kazi replies, look, you have come to my house in a very angry mood. So to pacify you, I did not come before you, but kept myself hidden. But now that you have become pacified, I have come to you. It is my good fortune to receive a guest like your honor. And Chandkazi is now continuing because he is now trying to placate Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He says, in our village relationship, Nilambara Chakravarti Thakur was my uncle. Now who is Nilambara Chakravarti Thakur? His maternal grandfather. So he is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mother's father, Nilambara Chakravarti Thakur. So he is from the same village as Chandkazi. So in the village, you have village, bye-bye. So this, he's saying that Nilambara Chakravarti Thakur was a older person. He was like my uncle at the time. Mamaji, such a relationship is stronger than a bodily relationship. Even today, some of my village people from my father's village, they come and they meet my father. They will talk in such a way that as if, you know, at the time, I will have no existence in that house. Son and all is not related. Village people relationship is very, very strong. I have seen that. Although I have never had such emotions because I'm a city-born person. But I have seen that those who are born in villages, their village ties of other people in the village is very, very strong. Cuts across Hindu, Muslim, doesn't matter. So now Chandkazi is saying that. And so Nilambara Chakravarti is your maternal grandfather. By this relationship, you are thus my nephew. He says like this and tries to placate him. When a nephew is very angry, his maternal uncle is tolerant. When the maternal uncle commits an offense, nephew does not take it seriously. And the Lord said, So now Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is replying, "My dear uncle, I have come to your house just to ask you some questions." "All right, please proceed. You are welcome. Tell me what is in your mind." Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, "You drink cow's milk. Therefore, cow is your mother. The bull produces grains for your maintenance. Therefore, he is your father. Since the bull and the cow are your father and mother, how can you kill and eat them? What kind of religious principle is this? On what strength are you so daring that you commit such a sinful activity?" So now Kaji replies, "See, as you have got your principles, your scriptures called the Vedas and Puranas, we have also got our own scripture. It is called Quran. According to Quran, there are two ways of advancement. One is called Pravritti Marga, method of enjoyment. Other is called Nivritti Marga, method of avoiding enjoyment, decreasing the enjoyment propensity. So on this Nivritti Marga, animal killing is prohibited. But on the Pravritti Marga, it is allowed. And by the way, so since we are doing it under the guidance of the scripture, there is no sin here. And for your information," this is Chand Kazi continuing, "that in your Vedic literature also, there is an injunction for killing a cow. On the strength of this injunction, great sages have performed sacrifices involving cow killing." So immediately, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, "No, the Vedas clearly enjoin that cow should not be killed. Therefore, every Hindu, whoever he may be, avoids indulging in cow killing. In the Vedas and Puranas, there are injunctions declaring that if one can revive a living being, then one can kill it for experimental purposes. So therefore, great sages sometimes killed old cows by chanting the Vedic hymns, they brought them back to life for perfection. So killing and regeneration of such old and invalid cows was not truly killing, but an act of great benefit. Formerly, there were powerful Brahmanas. They could do this experiment. But now, because of Kali Yuga, the Brahmanas are not so powerful. Therefore, killing of cows and bulls for rejuvenation is forbidden. Since you Muslims cannot bring killed cows back to life, therefore, you are responsible for killing them. Therefore, you are going to hell. There is no way for your deliverance. Cow killers are condemned to rot in hellish life for as many thousands of years as there are hairs on the body of a cow." Has anybody counted the number of hairs on the body of a cow? It's quite a lot. At least in the tail, there is lots. The rest of the body also is lots. And for each hair on the body, that many thousands of years, they have to rot in hell if somebody kills a cow. After hearing these statements of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Qazi, his arguments were stunned. He could not put forward any more words. And thus, after due consideration, Qazi accepted defeat. And he said, "My dear Nimai Pandit, what you have said is all true. Our scriptures have developed only recently. They are certainly not logical and philosophical. I know that our scriptures are full of imagination and mistaken ideas. And yet, because I'm a Muslim, I accept them for the sake of my community, despite their insufficient support. The reasoning and arguments in the scriptures of the meat eaters are not very sound," Qazi concluded. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was smiled and he was pleased with this acceptance of defeat. And he said, "All right, fine. I have one more question for you. My dear uncle, I have one question. Please tell me the truth. In your city, there is always congregational chanting of the holy names. A tumultuous uproar of music, singing and dancing is always going on. As a Muslim magistrate, you have the right to oppose the performance of Hindu ceremonies, but now you do not forbid them. I cannot understand the reason why." So in Chand Kazi's village, in his city, it was allowed. Recently, it has been allowed. It was previously prohibited, but recently, it has been allowed. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was asking, "What happened? How come you're a Muslim? You said all these things, good, but how come you're suddenly allowing?" Now, Chand Kazi says, "All right, I will tell you, but it's a little confidential. Can you please come to some private place? Then I will tell you." And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, "What is there? Please, no, there's nothing to be embarrassed here. Don't be afraid. All these people are my confidential men. They won't tell anybody else. Don't worry. Nothing will happen. You go ahead and tell me." So the Kazi said, when I went to that Hindu's house to break that mridanga and forbade the performance of congregational chanting, in that same night, in my dreams, I saw a greatly fearful lion roaring very loudly, his body like a human being and face is like a lion. While I was asleep, the lion jumped on my chest, laughing fiercely and gnashing his teeth. Placing its nails on my chest, the lion said in a grave voice, "I shall immediately bifurcate your chest as you broke the mridanga drum. You have forbidden the performance of my congregational chanting. Therefore, I must destroy you." Being very afraid of him, I just closed my eyes and trembled. Seeing me so afraid, the lion said, "I have defeated you just to teach you a lesson, but I must be merciful to you. On that day, you did not create a very great disturbance. Therefore, I have excused you and not taken your life. But if you perform such activities again, I shall not be tolerant. At that time, I shall kill you, your entire family, and all the meat eaters." After saying this, the lion left. But I was very much afraid of him. "Just see the marks of his nails on my heart." Then Chand Kazi opens his shirt and he shows in his chest there are nails, marks, nails like this. And when people saw that, they all, this has happened. But Chand Kazi says, "I did not tell about this to anybody. This is the first time I'm telling. I have not told this to anybody." But immediately after that, what happened? One of my servants came and he came running to me and he says, "When I went to stop the congregational chanting, suddenly flames struck my face. My beard was burned and there were blisters on my cheeks." So every servant who went gave the same description. They could not simply stop chanting anymore. Anyone who tried to go and stop the congregational chanting, there was a big flame that came. They could not cross. They could not stop them. So after seeing this, I became very afraid. I asked them not to stop the congregational chanting, but simply to go sit down at home. Then after this happened, some 5 or 6 non-believing Hindus came to me. And they complained that Nimai Pandit has broken Hindu religious principles. He has introduced Sankirtan system, which we have never heard from any scripture. When we try to sleep at night, you know, we are not able to sleep because it's making so much noise. And previously he was not so bad. He was a nice boy. But ever since he went to the Gaya, after he came back, he has become mad. He's doing all this. So the Hindus are complaining to me like this. And I just gave them some assurance and then they sent them back. So the Hindus, they're complaining, "We do not know what he eats that makes him mad. Sometimes dancing, singing, sometimes laughing, crying, falling down, jumping up, rolling on the ground. He has made all the people practically mad by always performing congregational chanting. He has spoiled the Hindu religious principles and introduced the irreligion of non-believers. Now the lower classes are also chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra again and again. For this sinful activity, entire city of Navadvipa will become deserted." So like this, people were complaining to him. So as he was describing, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu looks at him and says, "In describing all these events, you have inadvertently chanted Hare Krishna Maha Mantra." Because he was describing Hindus complaining, and the Hindus are saying, right, that Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, he's chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. He's chanting like this, making everyone mad. So Hindus, non-believers are complaining. And the same complaint Chand Kazi has related. In doing so, he has repeated Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, "By your having chanted Hare Krishna and Rama, all your previous sins have now become washed away. You have now become pure." So, because you have chanted these names, you are undoubtedly the most fortunate and pious. After Kazi heard this, tears flowed down from his eyes. He immediately touched the lotus feet of the Lord and spoke the following sweet words: "Only by your mercy have my bad intentions vanished. Kindly favor me so that my devotion may always be fixed upon you." The Lord said, "I wish to beg you for one favor in charity. You must pledge that this Sankirtana movement will not be checked, at least in the district of Nadia. And Kazi said, to as many descendants as take birth in my dynasty in the future, I give this grave admonition. No one should check the Sankirtana movement. So even today, the descendants of Kazi, they are very favorable. Even in the height of Indo-Muslim riots, they never create any disturbance. So we're running out of time, but I would like to describe one more pastime, very, very, very impactful and very difficult to accept pastime. One day he was chanting, Gopi, Gopi, Gopi. And there was one student, one neophyte student. He came and saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu chanting Gopi, Gopi, Gopi. He said, what is this you're chanting Gopi, Gopi? Why don't you chant Krishna, Krishna, Krishna? At least you'll get some pious benefit, punya you'll get. Chanting Gopi, what is the use? Now Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was in ecstasy, in the mood of Gopi. And somebody is coming and glorifying Krishna. If you remember in Vrindavan pastimes, when gopis are there in the mood of Gopi, sometimes they will chastise Krishna in their ecstasy. In their love for Krishna, sometimes they will be friendly towards Krishna. Sometimes the gopis are, they'll fight with Krishna. Sometimes they'll chastise Krishna. So as soon as he brought up the name of Krishna, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu started chastising Krishna. He said, Krishna, this Krishna, that he started chastising him in that mood of Gopi. The student could not understand. And then he kept saying, what are you saying? This is what are you, why are you saying, blaspheming Krishna like this? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took one stick and started hitting him, chasing him. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was in Gopi ecstasy. The student could not understand. He was thinking that he's doing something wrong. But then finally chased him away, and his disciples of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu restrained Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Otherwise, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was going to chase him and go hit him. So they restrained him, knowing his ecstasy and the mood of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So that boy, he went and he met other students like that. And they all started talking about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. What he's doing? He's crazy. He has become crazy. He's saying all bad things about Krishna. We thought he was a devotee, but he's doing like this. And they started doing all kinds of mental offenses, and they started discussing about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in negative ways. And as they start doing this, all their learning, whatever they had learned, they were sincere students, but they did not know this advanced pastimes and ecstasy, moods, bhava of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they did not know. But unknowingly, they have in their, out of their, you can say, just youthful ignorance, they started committing offenses. And as soon as they committed the offenses, they lost all their knowledge. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw this and he said, how can I save these boys? If these boys commit offenses against me, it will not be good for them. They will not be advancing in spiritual knowledge. They are students of Vedic literature. They are trying to study, they are trying to advance. But by simply committing this kind of an offense, they have lost all their knowledge. So he decided that he will take sannyas. And the thing about sannyas is that now, of course, there are so many false sannyasis that if some sannyasi goes like that, we don't even bother. But 500 years back, it was not like that. Even today, a little bit, to some extent, it is there. Some respect for sannyasis is there. But most people do not understand. But those days, 500 years back, it was very strong Vedic culture in that respect. Respect was there for sannyasis. No matter what a sannyasi says, certainly the ordinary people would offer obeisances and leave from that place. So they would not commit offenses. This much was there. So therefore, he decided that he will take sannyas and thereby get people to pay or offer obeisances. And he decided that once somebody offers obeisances to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, his sins will be washed away. And at that point, when somebody gives the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, they would be able to take up, and they would be able to take up devotional service. So simply offering obeisances to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is so strong. He was married, he had a beautiful wife and very affectionate mother. And he had already made a promise to his mother that he will not leave, but still he broke that promise. On account out of his compassion for the people in general, and he took sannyas. It was a very difficult sight to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, just a kaupina and one dress, bahi vasra, something called baha vasra, outer garment, one kaupina, one undergarment and one outer garment, that's all, nothing else. Shaved his head. Till then, when he was prior to this, when he was youthful, 16 years old, he used to dress himself nicely. He used to wear nice clothes and sandalwood pulp, long hair. He was very beautiful to look at. So now, 24 years of age, very young still, but just to save the population from committing offenses, he gave up everything, 24-year-old boy, and took sannyas. It was very, very difficult sight for everyone to see. It is described how his mother was distraught and she had to be pacified. But it was a great mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu upon everybody around at the time, the students and the population in general, that allowed people to take up the holy chanting of holy name without offenses. So there are the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya are endless, and the depth of the ocean of mercy is also limitless. The more we take, the more we dive into the ocean, the less we will want to come out of it. But time is short. I will stop here. If you have any doubts or comments, any thoughts, you can express. Before I stop, let us all come on the camera. Can you please turn on your cameras? And chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra after me. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare.
Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama.
Rama, Rama, Hare Hare.
Rama, Rama, Hare Hare.
Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki. Gaura Purnima Mahamahotsav ki. Shri Chaitanya Charitamrita ki. Jagat Guru Shila Prabhupada ki. Itai Gaur Premanande.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.